Welcome to 6.2, Newton's Law of Gravitation, Day 1 of 2. So the first slide I always like to start off with is the data booklet reference slide. So what you're going to see here are the formulas that we're used to looking at. So we've got three formulas here that are going to show up in 6.2. It is going to take us 2 days to cover this. So this is part 1 of 2, and next you'll see part 2 of 2. All right, so we've got three formulas here. Clearly, this one's a force formula, and then these two, well, you've seen the letter G before, but now you'll see what exactly it means. Okay, so at this point, I usually ask you to reference your data booklet. All right, so please take out your data booklets, your formula booklets. Okay, so you should have this in front of you. If you need to, pause the video and go find it. Okay, so make sure this is in front of you. One of the letters that we saw in those formulas was capital G, and this will come up again in the lesson, but just note, okay, gravitational constant capital G, and the number is right there. Okay, so make sure you're referencing to this as we go back and forth. The other thing with the data booklet, since we're studying section 6.2, you want to look at the section 6.2. Well, box 6.2 in the formula sheet. So if I go to box 6.2, you're looking right here, Newton's Law of Gravitation, and sure enough, those three formulas are right there. Okay, let's go back to the slides. So we're just gonna pass through this a little bit quickly, and here we go. So something that we've talked about in grade 11, and now we're going to revisit it again, is that there are four fundamental forces overall. We have the strong force, we have the electromagnetic force. Even though we learned these two as two separate forces, they are in fact one and the same force. Okay, there is the weak force, and then there is the gravitational force. All right, so now the strong force, that is what keeps the nucleus together. Okay, so something that you learned back in grade 9, even before, is that like charges repel. So if that's the case, how does the nucleus of an atom stay together? Okay, so in the nucleus, you've got a lot of positive charges. You've got your protons and you've got your neutrons. All right, so sometimes people will say, well, they're attracted to the electrons. Now, that is a completely invalid argument. If the electrons are orbiting around the nucleus, that would actually make the nucleus want to rip apart that much more. So that's definitely not something we want to say. That means if the, first of all, the positive charges are attracted to the negative charges, they want to move out of the nucleus. Plus, these positive charges are repelled between one another through electrostatic repulsion. That means there has to be an even stronger force keeping them together. And that's called the strong force, also known as the strong nuclear force. Okay, so that's what holds the nucleus together. And it is, in fact, the strongest force that we deal with. Okay. Electromagnetic force. So we spent the last unit studying this. Okay, so light is an electromagnetic wave. Okay, so we studied electric fields, and then we studied magnetic fields, and we know that with light, well, they occur together simultaneously. Now you have the weak nuclear force. The weak nuclear force is the force responsible for the spontaneous decay of radioactive elements. And finally, we have the gravitational force. So that is going to be our main topic in this section. Okay, so gravity. Now there it is in order of strongest to weakest. Gravity really is a very, very weak force in relation to the strong nuclear force and actually all the other forces. Okay. Now, sometimes the electromagnetic and the weak force can be combined as the electroweak force, and that's something that we're going to go into in too much detail. All right, Newton's law of gravitation. When most people think of Sir Isaac Newton, they remember the famous experiment with the apple falling from the tree, striking his head, and Newton having a eureka moment thinking, well, something caused the apple to fall. It didn't just get unhinged from the tree, something made it get pulled down, and that was due to the mass of the Earth. There must have been some kind of gravity present. So Newton's law states that if you have two point masses, M1 and M2, okay, there is a gravitational force proportional to their product. What that means is if one of the masses increases, the gravitational force will increase. And hopefully that's something that intuitively makes sense. If the Earth's mass was bigger, we would feel more attracted to it. If it was smaller like the moon, well, we would be able to jump much higher, kind of like what astronauts do when they go on the moon. And this force is inversely proportional to the square of their separation, r. Okay, so there it is. There's the universal law of gravitation, and that's the first formula in our booklet. Now, there's that g value again. So if you want to pause the video and take a look at your formula booklet, there it is. You're going to find that as the second item in your table of constants. Now, when you look at this formula, it should look very familiar. It should look just like the formula for Coulomb's law with electric forces. Coulomb's law said that you had a force of electrostatic repulsion or attraction equal to a certain combination of parameters. So let's just switch screens here for a moment. Okay. So Coulomb's law, what we saw in the last section, we saw that Fe was equal to K Q1 Q2 all over R squared. Okay, so the electrostatic force of attraction or repulsion was equal to the product of some constant K times the product of the two charges divided by the square of the distance between them. Okay, so you have, let's say, some charge Q1, you have another charge Q2, the distance between their centers is lowercase r, and then therefore there's some kind of electrostatic repulsion or attraction. Now what's interesting is that this gravitational force looks very much the same. So F, okay, you can put subscript G here, is equal to G M1, M2, all over R squared. Okay, so now instead of a charge Q1, you have some mass M1. Instead of charge Q2, you have some other mass M2. R is still the distance between their centers. Okay? And so this way you calculate the gravitational force. Instead of having K for Coulomb's constant, which was 8.99 times 10 to the 9, now you have G. Right? So the value for G, again, if you look it up in your data booklet, it's about 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11 Newton meter squared per kilogram squared, or kilogram to the minus 2. All right. There's going to be a lot of similarities between electric and gravitational force, and I'll come back to them as the time becomes appropriate. Okay, so back to the slides here. Okay, so the value for the universal gravitational constant, that's 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11, it was determined through something called the Cavendish experiment. If you're interested in that, there are many resources online you can look into to study more about this experiment. Okay, so don't worry about understanding what exactly the experiment was at this point. Simply understand what the name is and that that's what it was used to figure it out. All right. Now, those of you who have studied the astrophysics in the IB textbook will be a little bit more familiar with this. If you are not an IB or you have never studied astrophysics, which is perfectly fine, this might be a little bit different for you. Okay, so planets, stars, they all have layers. Okay, so let's focus on Earth. Earth has a few layers. We know that there's the crust. That's where we are. The mantle's underneath it. Then we've got the inner core and the outer core. Okay. So like it says on the slides, kind of like layers of an onion. If you recall back to when we were studying electric forces and electric fields, we said that we are going to approximate charges as if they are point charges, as if all of the charge is concentrated in the center. Okay, so we ignored the radius of the object. And so what we see now is that clearly, if you have a celestial object, I mean, the celestial objects being planets, moons, stars, they're the closest things we have to perfectly spherical objects. They're not perfectly spherical, but like I said, they're the closest things we have. And even these, we cannot assume they are acting like point masses. So what we have to do is, well, use something that Newton approximated in the last unit. In the last unit, we said that Newton used integral calculus to show that a spherically symmetrical shell of mass m acts as if all of its mass is located at its center. There was some derivation for that. It involves Gaussian surfaces and Gaussian integrals. You don't need to worry about that. That is going to be in university if you do cover it at all. The idea is you have two masses, one of them capital M, one of them little m. Okay, the distance between their centers is r. And, well, the force acts as if, and the field acts as if all of the mass is concentrated at its center. Okay, So this is for any spherically symmetric distribution of mass. And that's what we are going to be dealing with. Okay. So there's a note here on the top of the slide. Again, be clear that R is the distance between the centers of the masses. Sometimes problems will tell you, well, here is the distance from the surface of the planet, and this is the planet's radius. So you have to be careful in how you do your calculations. What I always recommend is draw a picture, and we'll do a lot of these problems so you get an idea what to expect. All right, so here in this image, I have mass M1, I have mass M2. They are a distance R apart between their centers. Now, mass M1 is attracted to mass M2 via the gravitational force. So we can call that force 1, 2. Okay, likewise, mass 2 is attracted to mass M1 via force 2, 1. Now, from what you remember in the last unit, in one of the first things we learned about in grade 11 physics is Newton's third law. Okay, so Newton's third law tells us that for every force, there is an equal and opposite reaction force. So these two forces are equal in magnitude and they're opposite in direction. Now, just because these two masses look like they're the same, that's fine. The forces are the same. Even if one of the masses was substantially bigger or smaller than the other, whatever happens to one force, the other force compensates the same. Okay, so the magnitudes are the same. The directions are opposite. Okay, so we've got a problem here. The Earth has a mass of 5.98 times 10 to the 24 kilograms, and the Moon has a mass of 7.36 times 10 to the 22 kilograms. The mean distance between the Earth and the Moon is 3.82 times 10 to the 8 meters. What is the gravitational force between them? Okay, so we're going to switch screens here. So let's go ahead and solve this problem. And hopefully you have the slides printed out in front of you. If not, well, you can always pause the video, go back to the question, and then come back to the solution here. All right, so like I suggest, draw a picture. All right, so you've got the Earth, you've got the Moon, okay, you have their masses, so let's just write those in. So the mass of the Earth is 5.98 times 10 to the 24 kilograms. Okay, so in the question, they call this capital M. It's up to you. I mean, either you have M1, M2, or you have little m, capital M, or you have M with a different subscript times M with another subscript. It doesn't matter as long as you're multiplying two masses together. Okay, so mass of the Earth, and then here we have mass of the Moon, 7.36 times 10 to the 22 kilograms. The mean distance between their centers, so that's this distance right here. You need an average distance because the Earth and the Moon are not always the same distance from each other. Even though we approximate a lot of the time that this distance is constant and that the Moon orbits the Earth or the Earth orbits the Sun in a circle, it doesn't. It's actually an ellipse. So an ellipse being an oval. And so R is 3.82 times 10 to the 8 meters. So this is not too bad. Okay, we just have to find the gravitational force. So we're looking for Fg. Okay, so the formula is Fg is equal to GmeMm over r squared. That's it. And again, if you're looking for the value for the gravitational constant, I mean, I wrote it up here. Okay. It's in your data booklet as well. Please make sure you're familiar with how to look it up. Everything you need is in there. So 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11. Newton meter squared per kilogram squared. Okay, that's going to be times mass of Earth, 5.98 times 10 to the 24 kilograms, times mass of the Moon, 7.36 times 10 to the 22 kilograms, divided by R squared, 3.82 times 10 to the 8 meters squared. Don't forget to square that denominator. Okay, so what we see here, just take a moment and look how the units are going to work out. I've got kilograms to the minus 2, so this is 1 over kilograms squared here. And I've got kilograms times kilograms here. So those two kilograms multiplied will cancel with this piece here. My meter squared will cancel out with the meter squared here, leaving me with newtons, which is the unit of force. So I'm good to go. Everything's an SI unit, so everything's appropriately plugged in. Now grab your calculator and carefully plug in the numbers. So 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11 times 5.98 times times 10 to the 24 times 7.36 times 10 to the 22 equals and divided by 3.82 times 10 to the 8 squared. Okay, so we end up with about 2.01 times 10 to the 20 newtons. Okay, what's the gravitational force between them? So just keep in mind, so if you are being asked from the Earth's point of view, the Earth feels this magnitude force towards the moon. And likewise, the moon feels this magnitude force towards the Earth. So since we're not asked from the perspective of a certain planet or celestial object, we don't need to put a direction. We are asked what the gravitational force is between them. So no direction is required, just the magnitude. So hopefully that's okay. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and move to the next slide here. All right, so we have the mass of the moon here. The mean distance between the Earth and the moon is 3.82 times 10 to the 8. What is the speed of the moon in its orbit around the Earth? Okay, so we are looking for speed. Now, in this particular case, whenever you're looking for speed, and you know that the speed is due to some kind of centripetal force, what you can easily do is the following. Okay, let me just get that centered. All right. So what you can do is set the centripetal force equal to whatever force is the centripetal force in that case, which in this case, it's Fg. Now, I know that centripetal force is mv squared over r, and Fg, well, I know the formula for that. I just looked at it on the previous slide. And normally I would put that formula here, gmm over r squared. But I already figured out, well, what the gravitational force is between the Earth and the moon. And the moon is at the distance from the Earth that was explained in the previous problem. So looking at this, we see that the force was 2.01 times 10 to the 20 newtons. That's what we're going to use here. 2.01 times 10 to the 20. And so what we need to do now is just calculate for V. And keep in mind, M here, that's the mass of whatever object has the speed. That's going to be the moon. Okay, so this is mass of the moon. All right, so rearranging for speed, it's going to be 2.01 times 10 to the 20. R is going to come across. Okay, so times R, we're going to divide by M. That's equal to V squared, so then we have to square root this to get V. Okay, so here we go. 2.01 times 10 to the 20. R, that's the distance between the Earth and the Moon, and the question you are told is 3.82 times 10 to the 8. And then divide by the mass of the Moon, that's 7.36 times 10 to the 22. Okay. So here we go, grab your calculator. Let's see, 2.01 times 10 to the 20 times 3.82 times 10 to the 8 equals, and then take that and divide by 7.36 times 10 to the 22, equals, and then square root that. Okay, so my speed is about 1.02 times 10 to the 3 meters per second. Okay, so about 1,000 meters per second. That's pretty fast. Yeah, we're moving through space pretty fast, and our solar system is moving through space, and our galaxy is moving through space. There's a lot of stuff moving, so we don't feel any of that motion. Okay, let's go back to the slides. Okay. All right, so continuing that problem, what is the period of the moon in days in its orbit around the Earth? So the time it takes for the moon to orbit around the Earth, or for any object to orbit around any other object, we can use a really simple, straightforward expression. And so going back to the work here, and so now we're trying to figure out the period here. So you've got the Earth, you've got the moon orbiting around the Earth. Now, if you remember what I said in section 6.1, As long as your object is not undergoing linear acceleration, you can state that the speed of the object that's moving in a circular path is equal to distance over time. Remember, you cannot use this formula if you have linear acceleration. I don't have linear acceleration here because the object is moving in a circle. If there was linear acceleration, you would not have a circular path. It would be, at very best, an oval, an ellipse. Okay, so when I travel in one circle, the distance to go around the circle once, that's called the circumference, that's 2 pi r. And the time it takes to go around the circular motion once, that's the period, capital T. So 2 pi r divided by t, that's equal to speed, and t is what I'm looking for. I'm looking for the period of the moon in days. So I'll figure out the period. Since this is a formula, physics formula, the number that's going to be spit out is going to be in seconds. So you will have to convert that, but that'll be a last step. So t is equal to 2 pi r divided by v. So 2 pi, now the distance between the Earth and the moon, that's, again, given in the question, and we already used that before. It's 3.82 times 10 to the 8 meters. And divide that by the speed. Well, we just found the speed. It's right there. Okay, so 1.02 times 10 to the 3. Grab your calculator and let's calculate this. So 2 pi times 3.82 times 10 to the 8 equals divided by 1.02 times 10 to the 3. And we end up with, that's a very big number. Not surprised, it's in seconds. So that's 2.353 times 10 to the 6 seconds. And you're in seconds, so that shouldn't be that surprising. So now I have to take that value and I need to convert it. I need to change the units to days as per the instructions in the question. Okay. So here we go. Anytime you're changing units for whatever reason, if you're changing meters to astronomical units, if you're changing feet to inches, whatever it is, you always multiply by 1. So 2.353 times 10 to the 6 seconds, I'm going to multiply by 1, and I might need to actually multiply by 1 again. So now you take that 1 and you replace it with an empty fraction. So that becomes 2.353 times 10 to the 6 seconds times, okay, so I'm trying to get rid of seconds. You replace your 1 with an empty fraction. Since you're trying to get rid of seconds, you put seconds in the denominator. I'm trying to get days out. No, I don't know how many seconds are in a day off the top of my head, but I know how many seconds are in, let's say, a minute or an hour. Okay, so let's just jump here for 1 hour. I know that in 1 hour, I have 3,600 seconds. 60 seconds in a minute, 60 minutes in an hour, that's 3,600. Feel free to do the calculation twice, though, if you want. Okay, I need how many days? So I multiply again by 1. So in fact, I have to do this twice. The reason I multiply by 1 is so that this way I don't change what the question's asking. Okay, so I'm just going to go ahead and multiply by 1 again. I'm trying to get rid of hours, so I'm going to stick that in the denominator here. I'm trying to get days out, so I put days in the numerator. So I know that 1 day, so I don't actually need the plural, 1 day is 24 hours. So by doing this, I cancel out seconds, I cancel out hours, and I'm left with days. So I have to do my number here, divided by 3,600, and then that divided by 24. All right, here we go. So grab your calculator. 2.353 times 10 to the 6 divided by, I'm just going to actually multiply these two in the denominator, 3,600 times 24. Okay, so I'm getting about 27.2 days. Now, I hope that answer makes sense. And so the question's saying, what's the period of the moon's orbit around the Earth? Okay, so this is the amount of time it takes for the moon to go around the Earth once. That's about a month. Okay, so that's pretty reasonable. All right, so going back now to the slides. All right, gravitational field strength. If you recall when we were learning about electric field strength, I kept using the gravitational analogy. Well, now you're going to be learning just about gravity. And so when you have a charge in space, or if you have a mass in space, they distort the space around them. Now, if it's a charge, now yeah, charge will have mass as well. So the charge will distort the space according to its electric properties, and it will distort the space according to its gravitational properties as well. Okay, so we are going to define gravitational field strength. And gravitational field strength, so this is lowercase g. You've seen that before. Usually we've set it to 9.8. So in this section, we're going to see that take on different values. This is the force per unit mass acting on m due to the presence of capital M. Okay, so with gravitational force, there has to be two masses involved. I cannot feel a force due to another mass unless there is another mass present. Okay, likewise with the charge, we saw that charges produce their own electric fields, but nothing will experience that field unless there is an actual other force there to feel it. It's the same with gravitational fields. Okay, so gravitational field, again, based on the definition, force per unit mass. Remember that the electrical equivalent was that electric field, capital E, was equal to electric force F per unit charge, lowercase q. Same thing. Okay, now you can see from the formula the units are going to be newtons per kilogram. If you remember with electric, we had newtons per coulomb. Coulomb was the unit for charge. Okay, the last two bullet points on this slide really just address the fact that, well, from Newton's second law, if you replace the acceleration with acceleration due to gravity g, well, you get the formula for gravitational force. So that's the big conclusion here. So what the number we've been dealing with so far is 9.8. That is on the surface of the Earth, as indicated here at the beginning of the bullet. If you move away from the Earth's surface, that value will decrease. If you are on a different planet, that value will change. Okay, so here we go. Suppose a mass m is located on the surface of a planet of radius capital R. We know that its weight is mg. Okay, but from the universal law of gravitation, this is the force now. And so I want to show you something. I'm going to move away from the slides for a moment and go back to the paper. I'll show you something here. Up till this point, when we've studied gravitational force, you've looked at the formula Fg, and of course you probably have also seen it as W, force of gravity, that's weight, that's equal to mg. Notice that, okay, I'm going to start now writing weight as Fg. These are the same thing, so whether I call it F little g or W, even F capital G, it's all force of gravity. Okay, so the force due to gravitational field strength G is equal to the product of the mass experiencing the field times G. So the mass in this formula is the mass experiencing field G, not creating field G. Okay, if you remember, the electrostatic equivalent was Fe is equal to QE. Okay, this was the electric force on charge Q that it was inside and experiencing electric field E due to another charge. Right? This was not the field of this charge. It was feeling a force due to this external field. Same thing here. We're feeling a force due to the external gravitational field, G. So what I'm trying to do here is come up with an expression for, well, G, lowercase g. I mean, where does that come from? How do we know that it's 9.8? Well, if we set Fg equal to F capital G, Fg on the left, that's equal to mg. On the right, we've got g mm over r squared. Okay, what I notice is that you have a mass canceling on each side, and I end up with the expression g is equal to capital G m over r squared. So the gravitational field strength due to a mass m, so this is the host mass, okay, and you are a distance r from it, you will feel this gravitational acceleration. Okay, now capital G, that's your 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11. Okay, so for instance, if I have the sun, I know that the gravitational field strength at location one will be much stronger compared to location two, right? So I'm going to have a very strong value for G here and a very weak value for G at location two. Okay. Now, since the sun is the object that I'm curious about calculating its gravitational field strength, the sun has mass capital M. So this small m that cancels, if there was a mass here to experience the force, this acceleration due to gravity, that is when you actually get force. So if I put a little mass m here at location one, if I know the field strength, now I can easily calculate the force at that point using this formula. F is equal to mg. Okay. If you don't know the value of g at various points in space around an object that's not the Earth, or even if it's very far from the Earth, if you don't know what little g is at that point in space, that's where you use this universal law of gravitation. It's universal, as the name suggests. It can always, always work. You can even use this when you're on the surface of the Earth. It will be tedious. You're going to have to plug in the value for g and the mass of the Earth and the radius of the Earth and then multiply by whatever mass you're trying to calculate fg for, but it'll work. So just understand how and when these kinds of formulas can apply. All right, back to the slides. So this slide is just going through that derivation that I just had. Okay, so there's the formula for acceleration due to gravity, gm over r squared, capital M, that's the object whose field g we are considering, and you are a distance capital R from that field. Now, the reason why there are two formulas on this slide, one with the capital R and one with the lowercase r, it's really one and the same thing. Hey, if capital R is your, if you consider the letter capital R to represent the radius of the planet, then this will be g, the acceleration due to gravity on the surface of that planet or that star or that moon, whatever object it is. Maybe it's an asteroid. For this formula, you are a distance r away from the center. So same idea. You have gm over r squared. R is the distance from the center. If that r happens to be to the surface, then you plug in the radius of the object. If it's more than that distance away, then you plug in the value between the center of each object. That's all. Okay. Practice. The mass of the Earth is 5.98 times 10 to the 24 kilograms, and the radius of the Earth is 6.37 times 10 to the 6 meters. Find the gravitational field strength at the surface of the Earth and at a distance of one Earth radius above its surface. Okay, so again, I'm going to have to switch screens here. So if you want, if you forget the numbers, pause the video, go back, go forward, whatever you need to do. So we're going to go back here. Pretty much what I'm doing here, using this formula, which again, I derived by setting the two expressions for gravitational force equal to each other. Using this, I'm going to show that the value for G on the surface of the Earth is 9.8, at least for the first part. Okay, so for the first part, normally I would derive this again, but since it's already here, let's just use it. So at the surface, so g is equal to 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11. The mass, this is going to be the mass of the Earth, 5.98 times 10 to the 24, that's in kilograms, and the radius of the Earth is 6.37 times 10 to the 6, and that's getting squared. So grab your calculator, 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11 times 5.98 times 10 to the 24 equals, take that divided by 6.37 times 10 to the 6, all squared, and we get about 9.83. So that's what you would expect. Okay, so 9.83. You can give the units in newtons per kilogram or meters per second squared. Up to you. All right, so that's what we expect. Now, the second part of the question says, well, figure it out at a distance of one Earth radius above its surface. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and use another piece of paper here for that. So in this particular case, we had the Earth, and we were here at the surface for the first case. So the distance between the center of the Earth and the object was just the radius of the Earth. But now you are at an additional distance of one Earth radius. So now this is another RE, which means the distance between the object, or the point, and the center of the Earth, that's 2RE. So that's going to be the distance that I use. Now, I don't actually have to go through this whole calculation again. I know that G is equal to GM over R squared. And really what's happening here is I'm doubling my radius. So R is becoming 2R. It's doubling. So if I do G, so let's call this R prime. The new R is twice the original R. So G prime is capital G M over R prime squared. So that's G M R prime is 2R, 2R squared. So this 2 gets applied to the R and the 2 inside. So that becomes 1 over 4 G M over R squared. So it becomes a quarter what it was before. So before it was 9.83, so if we take our calculator, you should still have the number up, divide that by 4, you're going to get about 2.46 newtons per kilogram or meters per second squared. Again, same thing. And if you want to actually physically calculate that out again, you're going to get the same value. And so what we see is that as you move away from the Earth, simply doubling the distance, we decreased the gravitational field strength by, well, to one quarter of the amount. Okay, so this is definitely an inverse square relationship. Okay, let's go back to the slides. So we've already done this, so we're going to move ahead. Okay, a 525 kilogram satellite is launched from the Earth's surface to a height of one Earth radius above the surface. What is its weight? A, at the surface, and B, at that altitude. Okay. So the satellite's launched, and now, well, we already just found in the previous problem. Well, we knew what the acceleration due to gravity was at the Earth's surface, but we calculated it exactly. It was 9.83 to two decimal places, and we found that the gravitational field strength when you are an additional Earth's radius away from the surface was 2.46. So using those values for G, let's calculate the weight. Okay, so going back to the worksheets here. And so again, we know the gravitational field strengths, 9.83 and 2.46. Let's find the weight. Okay, so this is that next example. So the weight, remember, weight is just force of gravity. Okay, so that's just mg. And remember that value of G can vary depending on where you are in space. So at the surface, that 525 kilogram satellite is going to have an FG value, force of gravity, 525 kilograms times 9.83 newtons per kilogram. All right, so grab the calculator, 525 times 9.83. We have 5,160, so 5,100, and let's make that 61 because of that decimal there, 0.75. 5,161 newtons. Right now, we're just doing this for illustrative purposes. Okay, so at the surface, we have this kind of a weight. Now, at the altitude of one Earth's radius, so now you are 2 Earth's radii away from the center of the Earth. So this is your gravitational field strength. That's what you're going to plug in for, G. So FG is equal to MG. Same mass. Your mass is not changing. 525 kilograms times 2.46 newtons per kilogram. 525 times 2.46. So that's 1291.5. If you want to round this to 4 sig figs, in reality, we should be rounding this to 3 sig figs to be exact, which would mean this number comes to 5160 newtons. And this one down here, well, let's see what's going to happen with that one there. Is the one going to round up or down? Well, it doesn't matter in this case. If you want to know, since it ends in a 5, you look at the number before. Since that number is odd, the rule dictates that we round up. So this would become 1292. But anyways, like I said, that doesn't really matter because we need 3 sig figs. So that's 1,290 newtons. The point is, look how much it decreased. It became 1/4 of what it was. Okay, so you would feel, well, almost 4 times lighter. All right. Good. Let's go back to the slides. Okay, so we saw in this formula, we saw universal law of gravitation, here's the force, we determined the expression for gravitational field strength, there it is. Okay, notice, so this slide is just pointing out the fact that the force has 2 masses in it, and the gravitational field strength only has 1. Just like for electric field strength, you only need 1 charge, or in this case, 1 mass, to create the field. In order for there to be a force, there has to be another charge or another mass to experience the other object's field, whether, again, it's gravitational or electric. And that's where these force formulas come into play. Okay. Now, let's talk about what it means to have a field. Okay, so this last bullet point says, the field view of the universe is a spatial disruption by a single mass and is preferred over the force view of action at a distance. Okay, so we will see that this idea of spatial distortion is actually more preferable compared to using this action at a distance model. And the reason being because these changes in the force cannot be communicated instantaneously. Okay, assume we're dealing with forces from the perspective of action at a distance. Okay, action at a distance force is something like gravitational force, okay, electric force, magnetic force. What that means is you don't have to have the two objects touching for there to be a force. Okay, so just because you have 2 magnets not touching each other doesn't mean they're not going to feel some kind of attraction or repulsion, depending on which poles are facing each other. But then you have forces that are, well, there are forces that you have to have interaction. Okay, so things like the normal force, you have to have physical contact for there to be a normal force. Frictional force, you have to have contact with the object again, otherwise there's going to be no resistance. Now, from the point of view of the action at a distance model, the object has to be able to adjust itself at every point in time instantaneously in order to change its curvature. So let's look at this scenario right here. So you've got, let's say this is the Earth, and the Earth is orbiting around the Sun. The Earth feels a gravitational force towards the Sun. And right now that force is going left, that's the red arrow. And its velocity is going down, it's tangent to the circle's direction. And so we know though, as this object moves slightly forward, the direction of that tangent will change and the direction of that little arrow will change. It's gonna now move a little bit in a different direction but still towards the center of the Sun. Okay, now, what we see is that, well, this object's moving in a circle, and while the velocity is always tangent, the direction of the acceleration and the force, namely the force, is always changing. Now, yes, it's always pointing towards the center of the circle, but sometimes it's pointing down, sometimes it's pointing right, sometimes it's pointing at some kind of an angle. And somehow, this Earth, it can keep adjusting itself. So even though it's orbiting around the Sun, if there was some kind of a force signal traveling between the Sun and the Earth, it would have to be traveling instantaneously so that the Earth could correct its orbit and be able to move around in a perfect circle. And now, according to Einstein's theory of relativity, he says that the fastest that any signal can travel is the speed of light. And as fast as 300 million meters per second is, that's not instantaneous. Okay, so what we see is this. If we explain this gravitational force and interaction via a force signal, in other words, an action at a distance force, what in reality would happen is that the Earth would not be able to change its trajectory at exactly the same rate that the gravitational force vector is adjusting itself. And so instead of moving in a perfect circle, this circular radius would keep increasing, okay, until this object eventually moves out and spirals outward. Now, that is not the case right now. That is not what we see. The Earth is orbiting its circular motion around the Sun, The moon is maintaining its circular orbit around the Earth. They don't spiral away. And what that tells us is there is some kind of instantaneous communication. And unfortunately, this force signal cannot be communicated with the force action at a distance model. And so we have to explain this a little bit differently.
Okay.
And the way we're going to explain this is using fields. Okay, so we solve this problem by introducing a field, like I mentioned. Okay, so just like you have charges that will distort the space around them, and there's going to be some kind of electric field in that space to which other charges can experience an electric force, gravitational force is just the same. Okay, when you have masses in space, they distort the space around them such that other masses can then experience a gravitational force of varying intensity and direction. Okay, so imagine you have a blanket and you have three different bowling balls. Okay, so these bowling balls, one of them has a mass of 0.1 kilograms, one has a mass of 1 kilogram, and the other has a mass of 10 kilograms. Just as you would expect, the heaviest one, the one that has a mass of 10 kilograms, will create the biggest depression inside of the blanket. So there will be the biggest curvature around it. And that is what you need to imagine, the spatial distortion caused by a mass due to its gravitational field. Okay, so in this example, this image should look very familiar. You would have seen this when we had a charge and we were investigating the spatial distribution around the charge due to its electric field. Now, what you want to do is assume this is the sun, and we are looking at the distortion of space around the sun in terms of the gravitational field. Okay, so now imagine you have some object, and this object is orbiting around the sun. It's going to orbit around with a certain speed. Now, if I take an object and I place it at a bigger radius away from the sun, notice based on this curvature that the slope at this point is not as steep as the slope as where this smaller green object is rotating. Okay, if the slope is steeper as it gets closer to the object, this object's got to spin much, much faster to prevent itself from falling towards the sun. Okay, this object at a bigger distance doesn't have to go as fast to prevent itself from falling towards the sun. And sure enough, if you put an object even further away, it doesn't even have to travel as fast as the last one, because now its curvature is almost flat. Okay, but if you were to place an object even closer to the sun, it would have to spin incredibly fast in order to maintain its position. Okay, of course, we can extend that view to even more objects. Now you can assume these are like planets around the sun. Okay, the further away the planet is, the larger its orbital period. Okay. Now, how do we figure out the direction of the gravitational field, or what about the strength? Okay, so in order to do this, we'll use test masses. If I place an object of mass M1 anywhere in this field, it will follow the field line towards the mass. Although with electricity, electric charges can attract or repel, with gravitational forces, you only have attraction. Okay, so if I put an object of mass M2, again, it will follow the field line toward the object, creating the gravitational field. Now, in reality, all of these objects are creating their own gravitational field. But since the sun is so much more massive, it doesn't move towards M2 quite as enough as M2 moves toward the sun, because the effect is much, much bigger. Okay, so these little red arrows showing the instantaneous initial direction of movement, these are the directions of the gravitational field vectors, G1 and G2. Okay. Now, the first question here on the slide is the field arrow is bigger for M2 than M1, and why? So just think about that for a moment. Why is it bigger? Right, so if you need to pause the video, go ahead and do that. The reason why it's bigger is because it's closer. Right, so you can even see based on the picture, there is a much steeper slope. It's going to move down much faster. There's going to be a greater attraction. Now, B, the field arrow always points toward capital M. Why? Because it is attracted toward this mass. like I said, the sun is attracted to small m, but small m is attracted to the sun even more. And we're going to see how that works when you have multiple gravitational field vectors in a scenario, how the net gravitational field vector will appear in relation to individual pieces. Okay. Now, in the previous unit, we did this very same thing, the hypothetical analogy. Well, if you have test masses and you place them at different positions around the main mass, you have the direction of the field vectors, in this case, gravitational field. And we can do this at a close distance. We can do this at a far distance. If you do it at a far distance, well, you've got your arrows here as well. And of course, we can keep doing this. But what we notice is that the field arrows in the middle, well, they're much longer than the ones on the outside. And the reason being, well, the slope is much steeper. This object will have a higher tendency and a bigger acceleration to flow down toward this mass. Okay, so there is a much stronger gravitational acceleration here compared to further away from the sun. Okay. Now, we don't want to draw those complicated space-time diagrams every single time we have to sketch a gravitational field. And so we have a very simple representation, two-dimensional. We have the sun. We have some arrows pointing towards the sun. We don't even have to really draw the sun. As you'll see, we're going to remove it. But we can even draw more arrows. And when you draw arrows further away, they should become shorter. So this is like an overhead representation. Okay, so this is implying that as you move further away, the field strength is decreasing. So like I said, we can even remove the sun. We don't even need it to be there. Okay. Likewise, we don't have to keep drawing arrows getting shorter and shorter. We can actually just represent this whole thing as arrows, well, long arrows going towards the sun. We will look at the strength through a different means, just like we did with electric fields. Okay, so we're going to remove the sun. If you remember from the last unit, this looks like the electric field pattern for a negative charge. The arrows are going towards. You will never have a gravitational field pattern where the field vectors are moving away from the mass because, well, gravity is only attractive. It is not repulsive. Okay. Now, how do we determine the field strength? Well, if you remember back to electric, even magnetic fields, we said that the density of field lines tells us the strength of the field. Okay, so when we look at the red and the green zones, I can see that the distance between the arrows and the red zone is much, much closer compared to the green. And that tells me that the field strength in the red zone is much higher than in the green zone. Okay, so whether you have two sets of arrows with different lengths, I mean, the length of the arrow can tell you that, or just analyzing those two different zones, like I said. In the green zone, the arrows are further apart compared to the red zone. Therefore, the strength is bigger in the red zone. Okay, sketch the gravitational field about the Earth, A, as viewed from far away, and B, as viewed locally at the surface. Okay, so I'm just going to show you something here. So we're going to switch to the paper again. So the first thing I need to show here is when you look at the Earth from far away. Oops. Okay, so from far away, so that means you see the entire Earth. Well, the Earth is like a spherically symmetrical shell of mass. So it's going to act like a point mass. The gravitational field vectors are simply showing attraction. And so I'm going to draw these arrows all the same length, equally distanced apart, going towards the center of that circle. And that's really all it is. That's how it looks like from far away. Okay, B, viewed locally at the surface. Okay, so I'm going to zoom in. So, you know, the reason why the Earth looks flat is if I was to zoom in on part of the Earth, like here, it would look flat, or there might be just a little bit of curvature, kind of like I've drawn here. I've drawn a little bit of curvature on purpose. Now, so when you were drawing the electric field patterns, or even magnetic fields, something that I mentioned is that the field lines should always be perpendicular to the surface. And so when you have something like this, You don't just want to draw arrows going down. They shouldn't be parallel in this case. They have to be perpendicular to the surface. So for example, in the middle, the arrow will look something like this. And as you move off to the sides, well, since the curvature of the Earth is changing, you have to change the direction of the arrow slightly too. Okay, so I'm going to draw it like this. I also have to be careful to keep the distance between the arrows the same. If you don't draw the distance between the arrows roughly the same, that means the field strength is varying from left to right. And that's definitely not the case. Okay. Now, here's where you have a bit of curvature. So if you were to follow all of these lines, they would meet somewhere in the middle. Okay, that's the idea. The lines should converge somewhere in the middle. If you were looking at a city, so I won't draw this one. I'll let you see it on the slide. If you simply look at a city snapshot, if you're just looking outside your window, the gravitational field vectors would indeed just be going straight down in parallel because you're just zoomed in at that point. So let me show you what that looks like. Okay, so here are the representations of the away, close up. If you are dealing with, like I said, you're just looking outside, the field vectors, they would look like they're going parallel and straight down. Okay, but you know that's because you're zoomed in and therefore the curvature of the Earth looks flat, looks horizontal. Okay. So what we can see, understanding the field line density is much easier when you look at this kind of a picture in A where the lines are very close together, as opposed to when they're a bit further away as you move outward. In part B, you can still tell the difference. I mean, the gap is getting bigger in the green zone compared to the red zone. In this picture, it's really difficult to tell because it's, well, I mean, the distance is the same. So you have to do this based on distance from the source, not the line spacing. Okay. Find the gravitational field strength at a point between the Earth and the Moon that is right between their centers. Now, truth be told, there is some information that is not directly told in the question that will come up in the image. Okay, so we've got the mass of the Moon, 7.36 times 10 to the 22. We've got the mass of the Earth. We've got the distance between them. After all, if you want to know what the field strength is right between their centers, you have to know the distance between them. So I'm going to go ahead and draw the same picture on my sheet here. So what I'd like you to do is take a sheet and draw that picture as well. So what I'm going to do is switch over here to my paper. Okay. So I've got the Moon, I've got the Earth, and always draw a picture. This is not just good to organize yourself and the problem, but it is excellent in terms of showing your work. So we know the distance between them, that's R. So 3.82 times 10 to the 8 meters. Again, we know their masses, so mass of the Moon, 7.36 times 10 to the 22 kilograms. We've got mass of the Earth, 5.98 times 10 to the 24 kilograms. And we want to know the field strength at the point right in between the two. So, well, let's figure out how far this is away from each of them. Since it's in the middle, it's going to be half the distance. So 3.82 times 10 to the 8 divided by 2, that's going to be 1.91 times 10 to the 8. Okay, so that distance, that's going to be right here, from here to here. Now, I can tell that, first of all, this is the distance between their centers. Not only is it in the picture, but I'm told that that's, well, between their centers in the question. So D is equal to 1.91 times 10 to the 8 meters. And that's the same for both of them, right? It doesn't matter which one you're dealing with. So let me just draw that in here just for completeness. D is 1.91 times 10 to the 8 meters. Okay, now you don't need a mass at this point in order for there to be field strength at that point. Just like you don't need a charge in a region of space around another charge for there to be a field. You need a second charge to feel the field, but there doesn't need to be a second charge for the field to exist. Okay, so at this point in space, there is a field contribution due to the moon, and there is a field contribution due to the Earth. Now, the very fact that it's at the same distance between both of them, obviously the object with more mass will have a greater contribution. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw the gravitational field vectors at this point due to the two masses. So due to the Earth, the gravitational field vector is going towards the Earth. Okay, so I'm going to draw a fairly long arrow here, and I'm going to call that G subscript E. That's the gravitational attraction due to the Earth. Okay, now, the moon is also going to have some gravitational field vector, and it's going to point towards the moon, but it's going to be quite a bit smaller than G. So I'm going to draw an arrow just a little bit shorter and call that G moon. So the net field at this point is going to be the sum of GE plus GM. Now, what I want you to notice is that the gravitational field strength, well, it's a vector. And if you haven't noticed that yet, because the direction can constantly change, well, now you know. Now you've made that connection. It's a vector. That means when I add these two, I have to take into account their directions. Okay, so you can probably already see from the picture that the net gravitational field at this point is going to be towards the Earth, because that arrow is substantially longer than this one. Okay, so after this gets canceled out, there's still going to be a little bit of GE left. Okay, so why don't we call this point P? So the gravitational field strength at P is going to be the gravitational field strength at E minus the gravitational field strength at M. Now, if you're not happy seeing the minus, you can always put a plus and then stick directions in. Right, left, up to you. Okay, now I know that the gravitational field strength formula is going to be gm over r squared. Now, just grab your formula booklet for a moment and just take a look here. The formula for g is here. It's in box 6.2. I don't know how well it's showing up on the camera, but it is here. Okay, so let me bring that up a little bit closer. It's a little blurry, unfortunately. Okay, so it's the third one there, gm over r squared. Even though it is there, make sure you are familiar with and comfortable with deriving that expression. So we're going to move this out of the way. All right. So G, this is mass of Earth, over this distance squared, we'll call that dE, minus G, mass of the moon, divided by distance to the moon squared. Now, these two distances in this question are the same. And the g value is a constant, that's the same. So I'm going to do g over d squared times mass of the Earth minus mass of the moon, just to make my calculations a bit easier. All right, plug in your values. 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11 divided by 1.91 times 10 to the 8 squared, and that is getting multiplied to mass of the Earth. 5.98 times 10 to the 24 minus mass of the moon. 7.36 times 10 to the 22. Here we go. All right, 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11 divided by 1.91 times 10 to the 8 squared times 5.98 times 10 to the 24 minus 7.36 times 10 to the 22. Okay. So what do we get? We have 0.0108 newtons per kilogram. All right, let me just go back to these slides here. Okay, so everything is in the slides. Now, if you're looking at that value, so on the slides, it's written in scientific notation. It's pretty small, right? So keep in mind, the reason why it's so small is because, well, you're so far from each object, and not to mention they are partially canceling each other out. So this answer does make sense. Now, what I see in the bottom of the slide is I see an arrow to the right. Okay, so going back to our worked example here, we got to put a direction here because, like I said, gravitational field strength is a vector. Okay, so originally we said that due to this GE being bigger than GM, this is going to take over, right? So this means that the direction is to the right. Now, I don't particularly like using right and left especially when you're in this kind of a scenario. I think the better direction here would actually be towards the Earth. Just as you can't use compass directions if it's not given in the question, using right and left here, it's not the best. Okay, so if the picture was given to you, that's a different story. You could say right, but the most direct, accurate answer would say towards the Earth, because that is exactly the direction it's going. Okay, so let's go back to the slides. Okay. Jupiter's gravitational field strength at its surface is 25 newtons per kilogram, while its radius is 7.1 times 10 to the 7 meters. Part A, derive an expression for the gravitational field strength at the surface of a planet in terms of its mass m in radius r and the gravitational constant g. Now, this is a repeat of what we've already done. We already have an expression for the gravitational field strength. We're not going to go ahead and do it from scratch again. I'll just walk you through how we did it in case you forgot. Okay, but we're not going to redo this entire piece again. We do Fg is equal to Fg, write the corresponding formulas, and we end up with the expression g is equal to gm over r squared. Okay, so we saw this already before. I'm not going to go through it step by step again. Okay, so let's go back to the slides. Okay. Part B, using the given information and the formula you just derived, deduce Jupiter's mass. Okay, so now we have the formula G is equal to Gm over R squared. We have to find Jupiter's mass, that's the host mass. We know the field strength is 25 newtons per kilogram. That makes sense. That's quite a bit bigger than 9.8 for Earth, because Jupiter is much, much larger. Here is its radius. Okay, so 7.1 times 10 to the 7. So going back to the paper here, so for part B, we are looking for m. Okay, so we have to rearrange this formula for m. So we get g r squared divided by capital G, that's equal to mass. All right, so let's calculate that. M is equal to, so this is 25 on the surface of Jupiter. R is 7.1 times 10 to the 7, that gets squared. Divided by 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11. Okay. 25 times 7.1 times 10 to the 7 squared divided by 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11. So the mass is 1.89 times 10 to the 27 kilograms. That's almost 1,000 times more massive than the mass of the Earth. Okay, so there we go. So going back to the slides. About 1.9 times 10 to the 27 kilograms. Two sig figs because there are two sig figs in each of the radius and the field strength. Okay. Part C, find the weight of a 65-kilogram man on Jupiter. Okay, so now that we know the field strength, we don't even need the mass. We're not really using Part B here. So let's go back to our sheet. Okay, so to find the weight of a 65-kilogram man, that means we're looking for the force of gravity. That's equal to m times g. And the value of G we know. Obviously, the man's going to be on the surface. Although, in real life, this question wouldn't work. Jupiter is a gaseous planet. You wouldn't be able to stand on the surface, but ideally, if you were somehow on the surface, this would be your weight. 65 times 25. 65 times 25, so that's 1625 newtons. All right, that's going to be quite a bit more than they're going to feel on the Earth. So going back to the slides. Okay. This is going to be the last slide for today for 6.2, day 1 of 2. Okay, so finishing off with a nice problem here. Two spheres of equal mass and different radii are held a distance d apart. The gravitational field strength is measured on the line joining the two masses at position x, which varies. Which graph shows the variation of g with x correctly? Okay, so what I noticed first of all is that x starts from the planet on the left. Be careful when you read the question. It tells you they have the same mass, but different radii. Okay, so you can see the one on the left has a smaller volume, but since the mass is the same, that tells you it's much denser. Okay, and gravitational field strength doesn't have to do with volume, it has to do with mass. So if they have the same mass, well, and you're closer to this one, technically, if you're at the surface of the mass on the left compared to at the surface of the mass on the right, the gravitational field strength for the mass on the left will be much higher because you're closer to its core. Okay, so what I note, first of all, is that the field strengths are not even when you're at x is equal to 0 or x is equal to capital D. Okay, so that means A and B are out. They cannot have the same magnitude. So these two are incorrect. Okay, I've already established that the field strength is highest here. Okay, so that makes sense. I have the highest strength when x is 0, and I have it lower when x is equal to D. Now, from the problem that you saw earlier, let me just go back to the pages here, show you something. If you remember this problem, we looked at a point between the Earth and the Moon. I mean, that's essentially what you have here. You have two different celestial objects. We have the gravitational field strengths going in opposite directions. Now, we just happened to pick the point exactly halfway between them, okay? And we found that, well, the field strength turned out to be something very, very small. That's almost zero. And in fact, if you had placed this point a little bit more to the left or a little bit more to the right, it probably would have hit zero. What that means is there is a place in between these two masses that you can put an object such that it doesn't feel attracted to either object. So right now, if I put an object right here at point P, it would very, very slowly move towards the Earth. But if I put it a little bit at a different position, it's possible that it wouldn't move at all if I put it in that exact position. So what that means is, and let's go back to the slides, what that means is at some point between these masses, probably a little bit further away from the denser mass, you're going to have, well, this value of gravitational field strength, the net field strength, be zero. And if you notice C never hits zero. It always is above zero. The only one that actually hits zero for a point is D. Okay, so you have the bigger field strength at the left, you have it hitting zero, therefore D has to be the correct answer. And sure enough, that is the case here. Okay, and the exact solutions are written here for you. If you have any questions on these, let me know. Otherwise, that is the end of lesson 6.2, day 1 of 2. Stay tuned for 6.2, day 2 of 2, next time.